Arise, my India, was the clarion call used by Swami Vivekananda to awaken a nation. The Indian civilization remained intact for thousands of years because it relied on spiritual aspirations rather than on material gain. After independence, this spiritual focus was lost. We hope this series of talks, inspired by the teachings of Swami Vivekananda and Sri Ramakrishna, will reignite the spiritual flame of modern India.
There's another incident in his life which is very special because it throws light on how easy it is for this boy to become one-pointed. At a drop of a hat, he becomes very one-pointed. I'll just give an example. When he's about 10 years old, in the little village, they were going to perform on a Shivaratri night, they were going to perform a play on Shiva. So they'd got all the little boys and girls and little actors to play the parts of various deities and somebody to play the part of Shiva. Standard stuff in a little village. How do they celebrate? Gods and goddesses. So the play was going to be performed, and then just on the night of that particular day, Shivaratri, the actor was supposed to play the part of Shiva, a rumbling in his tummy. So he had to be, because suddenly you can't have Shiva running to the loo, you know, suddenly. So they excused him. They said, we'll leave you out. So they said, they looked around, who will play the part of Shiva? And they looked at this little boy called Gadadhar, said, Gada, you play? He said, no, I want to play. Say, pray Shiva night. I don't want to do plays. I'll just pray. No, you play the part of Shiva, they said. He said, all right, let's do the part of Shiva. Last person who should have been, asked to do the performance was this poor chap. And he was, they decided on him. So this Gadadhar was dressed up, with whatever poor villagers could, kind of uniform or clothing they could find to depict Shiva. They dressed him up. He was just 10-year-old chap. And now, with the drum beating, Shiva entering the stage, So this poor boy was led onto the stage. He came with his trishul, a little kind of something curled around his neck, which is supposed to be a snake. And he walked in. But this little boy, you should not, because without prompting, he was hitting the high notes. Now he's being prompted by the public to play the part of Shiva. That's the last thing you do to this boy. And he was asked to come on the stage. He came with his little trishul, this trident, dressed up. He came in the middle of the stage. He looked at everybody. His eyes started to water, tears of joy flowing. And again, I tell youngsters, because children like to distinguish between tears of joy and tears of pain. And this is something very technical. It's good to tell. The tears of pain come closer to the nose. They flow this way. So when you smack somebody or you get smacked, you know where they come from, the tears come from. The tears of joy come from the outer edges. Somehow there is some technical reason for it. And this boy was standing in the pose of Shiva, posture of Shiva, and tears of joy were flowing like torrent down his eyes. And the audience was stuck, dumbstruck. So what to do? The play came to a halt. Because how can you do a play with a Shiva standing like this with the tears of joy coming down? And this is a true story. He was like that continuously throughout. So the play came to immediate halt because Shiva was not playing his part anymore. So the play came to a halt and he had to be carried away because he was like that. He had to be carried away and the Shiva role did not finish till another 24 hours. He was like that. He couldn't get out. Why? Let me tell you why. You see, when you are one-pointed and you're already prepared, you already come, the ground is prepared, you are not doing sadhana to achieve some end. You are already dhyana siddha. You are already established in the highest level of meditation. It's just that nobody has prodded you to show your colors. So when they prod you by making you wear Shiva costume, then they're asking for trouble. Once you prick that outer layer, the reality flows out. So that boy was in the mood of Shiva, instantaneously being able to transform himself and become one-pointed on the principle of Shiva and lose his individuality. You see, we struggle to lose our individuality. We are stuck. We are shackled by our individuality. And we think we kind of embrace it, think, that's me. What me? That's a nuisance. But this boy, when you prick that individuality, suddenly bursts forth and shows nothing but the spirit. So this Shiva play came to an end, and the boy showed his colors, and the parents were worried. Look, these are people in the villages. They thought something is wrong with the boy. We need to get him, you know, some vaid, some medicine man to sort him out, or some, you know, bhoot preth has, you know, entered the boy, you know, some ghost has entered the youngster, so let's sort him out. They did all these things, and the boy was perfectly normal in every sense. Of course, this is the story that carries further. Now this boy is there, again he's spending more and more time in the cremation ground. Now if a boy starts spending time in cremation, it's very morbid, bit worrying. You have to be worried, you have to be worried, I'm telling you. It's all right for Ramakrishna, but for us it's very worrying. You have to be, you know, taken to the psychiatrist. But this boy started spending time in a mood of renunciation. From a very young age, beginning to show his tendencies, his, if you like, his attraction to nothing but the highest. Anything less will not do for him. The story continues. While this was happening, he had an older brother called Ram Kumar, who had moved to Calcutta and was running a little, you know, like a school, teaching children, giving private tuition in grammar and language and other stuff, ritual practices. So he was earning, eking out a living that would just make enough money for the family to survive. But he was struggling, the poor man was struggling in Calcutta. Now, let me open another chapter of the story that was unfolding in Calcutta. The stage, you see, this little boy had a little stage in the little village and played the part of Shiva, and maybe 50-100 villagers saw what weird thing he was doing. But surely this boy has come to play a part on a bigger stage, on an international stage. So the village had to be, a bigger stage had to be created for him. And the story is unfolding now in Calcutta. In Calcutta lived a very rich widow, a very powerful personality called Rani Rasamani. She was a dynamo. She was considered to be one of the most kind of powerful personalities of Calcutta, a woman, a widow. Real powerful, real kind of battle axe is the right word. Just to give an example of this Rani Rasamani and her power, very rich, because her husband has left a huge amount of kind of property for her, lots of land all over Calcutta, very rich and very headstrong. Just to give an example, when in one of her pieces of land, some people were doing a performance, and you know, for a particular religious festival, they were playing musical instruments, and there were kind of British soldiers in the regiment living nearby who complained, "This is noisy for us." But they said, "This is India, this is Indian festival we are celebrating and playing instruments." And they complained. So the Rani Rasamani said, "Bring on more musicians, play louder." She was like headstrong like that. "Bring more musicians. This is our country and this is our religious festival. Play more loudly." She was incapable of all that. They're very headstrong. So they brought more musicians and played even louder that night. And those people complained even more. And it's British rule. They said, "We will fine the Rani Rasamani. We'll take her to court and fine her for nuisance." They took her to court and fined her 50 rupees. This is a real story. I told you this is a new, unusual katha. They fined her 50 rupees, and Rani Rasamani, "I sold you out." Now the soldiers had to pass through the land that belonged to her. Next day she put up barriers. So the British Empire will come to an end. They can't go through me because this is my land. They want to take me to court, I will take them to pieces now. They had to beg for forgiveness and say, "Let our soldiers come through and come out and come in." She was able to stop the empire. This woman was very headstrong, very powerful, unusual. You see, whenever a great personality comes, he comes with helpers around him. And she was one of the helpers being prepared to build the stage on which Ramakrishna could do his performance. And the stage was being set. This Rani, because very powerful, major kind of, you know, developer in that part of the world, when she said, "I want to go on a pilgrimage," she would spend hundreds of thousands of rupees just for a pilgrimage. Hundreds of thousands of rupees in those days is a huge amount, few lakhs of rupees. She said, "I am going in a pilgrimage to Kashi now, let's go." So there'll be a whole train will be hired for her and she'll be off. So all this thing was being prepared. Just on the night she was going to go, begin her pilgrimage. This is the magical part of the story. He wants a bit of color. I told you, I warned you. I'll be very careful not to exaggerate. So the Rani, this is her account. On the night she was just going to start her journey, she had a vivid dream. And in the dream, she saw the mother goddess appear. Now again, let me tell you about dreams. Most of the dreams we have are such nonsense, they kind of rattle things together and they come up in kind of weirdness. Sometimes, once in a while, all of us would have experienced certain dreams which appear to be more real than reality itself. Because we wake up feeling completely charged up or feel thoroughly excited. We feel this is more than dream. This is the kind of dream I'm talking about. So in that dream, which appears more real than reality, she sees the mother goddess. And the mother goddess says, look, my daughter, forget about going to, Kashi and worshipping Annapurna there. You know, the mother goddess, Parvati. Forget about that. Do you know what I want you to do? Spend this money in order to invoke me, the mother of the universe, will come on the banks of the Ganga and accept your offerings. Prepare land and install me on the bank of the river Ganga, and I will become manifested there. I will appear there. You see, most of the temples are built, you put deities there, the deities stay deities, and we think they are alive, and we keep praying, good for us. But here is the mother goddess saying, install me, I will come alive, my daughter, install me. And this Rani was thrilled. You see, when you get a dream of that nature, you know this is real. If the dream was kind of just an ordinary dream, she would have just brushed it aside. But when you get a dream of this nature, you can't push it aside. You are hooked on it. So this Rani woke up and said, cancel the pilgrimage, look for land. And because there was a lot of jealousy and this Rani was from a lower caste, people would not give her land, even though she had all the money. On the bank of the river Ganga, it's difficult to find land. And she found some derelict land, which was kind of some officer's land, some Englishmen used to live there, and there was a cemetery with Muslim kind of graves there. She said, no problem, Mother Goddess doesn't mind. We'll go for that land. She picked up that land on the bank of the river Ganga. The river Ganga is on this land is on the east side of the river Ganga, flowing down into the sea. 4 miles north of Calcutta is the little land she purchased. It's called Dakshineshwar. She was very rich. She had lots of money. So I think in those days she spent about 900,000 rupees to build a temple there on the banks of the river Ganga. She hired the best architects, the best planners, the best masons, and a temple started being built in 1844. The groundwork was being set. The stage was being prepared, properly prepared for this personality to come and do his real play. The stage was being prepared. So here was in Dakshineshwar, we see a Kali temple built. The Kali temple is still there. You can visit it. Most people do. I think Krishnamai must have been there last month. The Kali temple has got, of course, the central deity is Kali. Now people shudder. You see, in fact, there's a primary school book which says, Hindus worship this bloodthirsty goddess called Kali. So, well, this is what Ramakrishna was being prepared for. So Kali temple is built. The central deity is Kali, carved out of black stone. The same image is still there, carved out of black stone. She is, if you like, the idea of Mother Goddess in all its potency. And she doesn't cut any corners. She is very blunt and basic. That's why shown in black, the Mother of the Universe, the Creator and the All Destroyer, the Bhavatarini being shown there, being prepared. So it's a Kali temple. And the Rani was very comprehensive. She was a pluralist, you can see. Just in the same ground, she has got Radha Krishna temple, so you got the Vaishnavai tradition. Does she stop there? No. She built 12 Shiva temples, 6 on either side. So 12 Shiva temples, one temple devoted to Radha and Krishna, and one temple, the central temple, devoted to Kali, sits on the bank of the river Ganga. And the groundwork was being prepared for this little boy to come and do his play. This is the story unfolding on the banks of the river Ganga. Now Ram Kumar, the elder brother of Ramakrishna, had to come to Calcutta to earn a living. And he was struggling to make ends meet. He thought, if I can bring my brother over, perhaps I can increase my income. He was struggling to pay the bills. He was getting into debt. He said, let me bring my younger brother Ramakrishna from Kamarpukur into Calcutta so he can become a help for me. Very practical idea. So he invited, he took Ramakrishna with him to Calcutta, and Ramakrishna, little boy, said, "Yes, brother, I will come, whatever I can do." And he said, "Okay, try and teach." He said, "That's not my business." He was like that. You see, again, this renunciation is something that is central. Without that strong renunciation, a strong idea that I want my priorities to be right, spirituality can never flourish. Examine our own lives. Because our priorities are always more materially oriented, we are not able to make much progress spiritually. If we get our priorities right, and spirituality that is the top end, we will start making very fast progress. So here is this, Ramakrishna saying, "No, I'm not going to learn or teach or make little money to just survive. My aim is for the higher things." I think very high-flying, idealistic boy. How does this story progress? So he's 17-year-old, brought to Calcutta. He's still a bit aloof, but for whatever reasons, I tell you how he got involved. One day, again, you see a unique feature about special personalities of the Hindu tradition is this. Please watch out. Whenever you have a kind of a major personality, a real giant showing his colors, he will be able to show, give you a lateral understanding of your religion. He will not use the same format used by the previous ones. He will show a continuity with the previous teachings, and yet he will come out with novelty, a novel approach. This is a unique feature, watch out. Whenever you find any guru, any swami, any teacher, any proponent of Hinduism who falls back just on the old literature and then interprets and reinterprets, he is showing his limitation. The real giants produce new material. The stuff that comes out of their mouth is the modern new vision of spirituality, lateral, different, dynamic and unusual. And this was becoming, I'll just show you an example. So this Ramakrishna was playing around, staying with his brother, just staying with him and not doing much really. During that period, one of the pujaris, priest, who was looking after the Radha Krishna temple, took out the image of Krishna, and on that day he was supposed to go for a little trip. Krishna goes around, on certain days they take him out on a little wagon and, take him for a tour. So they were taking him out, Jagannath Puri and Yatra time. So they were taking him out, the poor man was taking out, the priest was, and the floors were a bit slippery, and he slipped. And the murti of Krishna fell on the floor, and the leg broke apart. Now I just show you the level of superstition, and if you like, the lower understanding of religion. As soon as that happened, there was tremendous, bustle and hustle in the temple, saying, everybody saying, "Oh dear, what's happened? A serious calamity is going to descend on the temple on Rani Rasmani. The image of Krishna broken, the leg broken, this is a signal of calamity to approach the life of Rani Rasmani. This is terrible, everybody is worried, Rani Rasmani is worried, what will happen to me?" See the level of superstition. Oh yes, the Shastra, they immediately pull out the Shastras. And this is visible in modern times. We discover they fall back on Shastra, or cremation or whatever. They pull out the Shastras. They said, leg broken, very inauspicious sign. The Shastra says, you are in trouble. Your whole generation will be wiped out. This is written here. So they'll find some text like that. They discover that, this is terrible. And Rani Rasmani collect all the pandits, come sit together, advise me, what should I do? What should I, this has happened. They say, Rani, this is sad, but this only way what you can do is do visarjan of this particular image, means immerse it in water and get another new one made, and again, prana pratishta, make that image come alive and install it, reinstall another image in place of this Krishna. And they were arguing and fighting with all the pandits, and this is the only advice given to her. This is the only way you go forward, otherwise calamity. And while this was happening, this Ramakrishna, this little boy, was listening. And he said, "Look, can I just ask, because this Rani Rasmani had four daughters. She had no sons, four daughters, and all the daughters had, of course, husbands, son-in-laws. So now this is the example, you see, this is the kind of modern interpretations." He went and said, "Look, if Rani Rasmani's Jamai, son-in-law, broke his leg, would he replace the Jamai?" You see how blunt and honest it is, and immediately catches your attention. You don't replace yours because your leg is broken. This is not acceptable. This is what a silly thing to say, that you replace, because the leg is, this is terrible. the moment he said, everybody said, yeah, this sounds very, you see, this is what I mean by lateral interpretation. Very honest and shows his uniqueness. Unless a personality shows the uniqueness in interpreting religion, don't believe them. He must be unique. Every situation that he faces, he will come up with a unique reply. He will never give the standard stuff or fall back on the scripture saying, oh, let me look in page number this. And there are different pages with different instructions. You know that. You get lost in that. It's all jargon there. And you get completely lost in the jargon and you say, where are we? And they can. That's how the Hindu tradition carries on. Just kind of getting lost in the jargon. And here is this man giving a very literal explanation. Rani Rasmani Jamai, because Rani Rasmani Jamai was running the temple. He was telling, would you replace him if he fell down? And they said, no, we repair it. So he said, all right. They took his advice. A 7-year-old boy gave this advice. And the Pandits were saying, we haven't seen that anywhere in the scriptures. He said, repair. Repair the image and put it back. They said, we'll repair. I told you this boy had many, many kind of artistic qualities. And in the village, he picked up one art, which was to make images. He could make excellent images himself. He was no good in times table. Very good at making images. And Sita is smiling, yeah, good stuff, that's what I like. So he could make images, and he said, give it to me. And he repaired that image of Krishna. It is still in the Dakshineshwar temple, and you can't see the joint where it has been repaired. He done a marvelous job. So you see the leg is properly set, and the son-in-law is safe. So he is working properly, and that Krishnamurti is still there in the Dakshineshwar temple, the one that this Ramakrishna repaired. The story continues. Now you see this Rani Rasmani and this son-in-law. Let me mention the son-in-law, because he's one of the characters. You see, the important thing about this story about Ramakrishna, Katha of Ramakrishna, is I'm not just presenting one personality. I'm showing you how this personality relates to various other people who come in his life and how he influences all of them, how he manages to turn them, how he manages to wind them up, how he manages to lift them up. And you see, when we look at all this personality, we will immediately, like the soap opera, we'll start attaching ourselves to certain person. This sounds like me. We'll begin to relate to certain personalities in a very personal manner. This is the whole idea of a katha. You see, when you are children, you do the katha of Ramayana, most children immediately relate to the idea of character Hanuman. They say, that's me. And Hanuman's ups and downs are their ups and downs. They go with it. They flow with it. In the same way, when we do this modern katha, you'll find various characters appearing, like Rani Rasmani, a real battle axe fighter. And you find various other characters appearing as the katha goes on. And all of them very interesting, all unusual, all different. And you see how this wonderful personality called Ramakrishna interacts with all of them and how he lifts them all up in an unusual manner. All different. Again, a feature of a super personality is this. When he gives a message or tries to interact with any individual, he will do it in a very individual manner. He won't just give one prescription that fits all requirements. He will never do that. Depending on who he's dealing with, his prescription will be just focused for that person. This is the unique feat. They know what to do. They are masters. So they will give different prescriptions to different personalities that they interact with. With some they smile, with some they tell them off. Same person, different messages. Again, shows the versatility of a spiritual personality. They are not set in a rut, not stuck. They give a prescription that suits the need of that particular patient. Like if you went to a doctor, like suppose you went to Dr. Kaka, and suppose you just give the same prescription to every patient who comes. I think 99 of them would die, and one person would survive, you know, there are the fish, some of fish. So you never give the same prescription to different patients, you give them different prescriptions to, you know, rid them of the illness or sickness of this worldly life that we lead, to relieve them of the pain that we suffer in our routine life. So you have different prescriptions, and this Ramakrishna is master. That's why you'll see him interacting differently, and you'll see how he interacts with Rani Rasmani in a minute too. So this story goes on, and now we bring in a new personality, the son-in-law of Rani Rasmani, who is in charge of running the temple, because she had only son-in-laws. So she had no sons, and they were running the whole show. The huge kind of major corporation they were running in Calcutta. Very powerful personalities. I mean, of equal stature to Devendranath Tagore, you know, equal stature. They were on that level. So here is, now I'm introducing this other gentleman called Mathur Babu. Rani Rasmani's son-in-law. Unique personality, unusual personality, but very sharp. He kept watching this Ramakrishna and said, this boy is special. the way he looks at them, you know, he's doing various things, and the way he kind of decided to repair the image shows he's very unusual. And you would observe him on the banks of the river Ganga, sitting sometimes, meditating, making images from sand of certain gods and goddesses, and sitting in front of him, meditating. You would watch and say, unusual boy. I wish I could somehow employ him. So they tried to say, would you like to work, assist, you know, with these ornaments or something? He said, no, go away. He would run away. He would just reject. He wouldn't accept employment. He wasn't bothered. And that made Mathura Babu even more keen to employ him. He said, this is the right fellow. He doesn't want money. Something more special is becoming visible in his life. I want him strongly involved in my temple. So he was after him all the time. While this was happening, again, another kind of mishap in the life of Ramakrishna. His elder brother, Ramakumar, at a very young age, died suddenly. And he was one of the priests in the temple. Now he's gone. So it became essential for them to find a replacement. At this stage, they decided to catch hold of this Ramakrishna. Look, we are struggling. Become a helper to the priest or do something for us. We are struggling with manpower here. Please assist. And this boy somehow casually agreed. But now, the story goes into a different phase. Because this Ramakrishna is asked to worship, and his way of worship is very unusual. It's not normal in any sense. See the difference between a real devotee and a make-believe, if you like, a superficial devotee. Here is a real devotee. When he's looking at the image of Mother Goddess, he becomes very, you know, enlivened. He's somehow not satisfied to see a deity in the form of a piece of stone that he keeps worshipping. So he keeps looking at her and says, oh Mother, are you for real or just made of stone? Real devotion begins to pour out from his heart. He is no longer satisfied. You see, with us, we go to a temple, we look at the deity, we bow down, we offer coconut and come home. We are satisfied. This young man is not satisfied. He says, oh Mother, are you for real? If you are for real, why can't I see you? Show yourself to me, oh Mother. And the way he was worshipping, for example, some artist, it would be going on for hours because he keeps imploring her. It doesn't follow the ritual, the timing of the temple. So it kind of things get dragged. And the people in the temple get worried and say, Mathura Babu, look at this. He's an idiot. Throw him out. He's a madman. The way he's worshipping is not according to the Shastras. He's, you know, abandoning everything in the Shastra and doing what he likes and worshipping in a unique manner, unusual manner, not prescribed in any Shastras. You must kick him out. He's a madcap. And Mathura Babu says, I'll test him out. One day he came quietly and watched this Ramakrishna imploring the Mother Goddess. He was in hiding, didn't want to show himself. And the way with the devotion with which this boy was imploring the Mother Goddess, I tell you, stone would melt. Forget about Mathura Babu's heart. It would melt. You could see the genuine devotion pouring out of this young boy, young man. And Mathura Babu said, look, if anybody gets in the way of this boy, I will take him to task. Leave him alone. Let him worship the way he likes. Do you know why? He said, he is going to make sure the Mother Goddess becomes manifested in this temple, and the purpose for which this temple was built will be fulfilled by this young boy. He could see that boy, see the power of that boy. An ordinary, you know, employer would have kicked him out. He said, no, no, this is special boy. I recognize him. Leave him alone. Let him be. And the story continues.